Hello, everybody. I am Jarrett Ross, the GeneaVlogger, and on today's vlog, we will be continuing researching the family tree of Sam Aronow. Now, in the last two episodes, which technically I shot as one episode and then editing, I decided it's way too long for just one. I mispronounced Sam's last name. I said Aronow, and it's supposed to be pronounced Aronow. But this is actually a good point that I do want to bring up when it comes to names, and that can be that you can have a variation on how one family itself will pronounce a name. Now, one reason I pronounced it Aronow is in my research and in my experience, that's often how that name is pronounced, but not always. In my own family, I have a family name of Ekoff, but then there's a whole other branch of my family that I know is related through DNA, and they say it Ekoff. So could we be dealing with something like that? Am I just completely wrong, or is there something more going on? And that's something we will probably find out today. So last we were looking at Joseph Aronow, and he was really difficult to find anything on. We found his death record, we found his grave, but we really couldn't find what we were looking for, which was mostly the naturalization records, the immigration records, the manifest records, or a draft record, which he might have been too old to have had any draft records, because we would only expect the World War I draft record, but at that point he would have probably been in his 50s. So he might have been outside of the age group that needed to do the draft. But what we're going to do today is we're going to jump into more of the research phase of things. And while I would usually spend a lot more time looking into Joseph and the American records and kind of building out that family tree for like his children and seeing if there's any information that the other children might have to help open up that side. But for the sake of this video series, I do want to cover a lot of different stuff, so we're going to kind of jump a little bit ahead. So once again, I'm showing the family tree just so we can kind of get a view of it. And we haven't expanded it beyond what Sam sent us at this point, but that's what we're going to try to do. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to start trying to find records for Joseph and Jacob, possibly, looking for records back in the Bryansk region, specifically the town of Mglin and the town of Starodub, which we know the family has ties to, at least based for Mglin, based on what Sam has supplied us. So the first place that I'm going to look is I'm going to look at Jewish Gen, because this is going to be similar to a search phase where Jewish Gen specializes in Jewish records that you won't find a lot of them on Ancestry or Family Search, although you may find a good amount of them on Family Search, just not digitized and searchable. So going to Jewish Gen, for those who are not familiar, this is the page of Jewish Gen. There's all sorts of stuff you can do, but what we're going to do is we're going to go into databases and we're going to go to Unified Search, and this searches all of the databases. Now, my screen's going to look a little bit different because I do donate to Jewish Gen. It's $100 a year to donate, and then you get more access to stuff. So for those who haven't donated, you only have access to these first two keyword spots. For those who have donated, which I suggest donating, especially if you want to help further the Jewish genealogy field, and you know they do a lot of amazing projects for Jewish genealogy. But what we're going to do is very similar to what we did on Ancestry. It's just we have a lot more limited space. So we're looking for the family Aronow. And knowing from my own experience with Jewish names, it's probably not going to be Aronow when we find it in the Russian Empire back, you know, when Sam's family lived there. Or Aronow, excuse me. But it's going to be Aronov or Aronov. So we're going to do Aronow just because, just so we can see what comes up, and we're going to keep it phonetically like. Now, there's a lot of options
Just to give an idea, fuzzy match means that one letter is different than what you put in. Fuzzier match, I believe, is two letters, and then fuzziest match is there's three letters different than what you put in. But I personally like phonetically like, but you can try each different one, see what comes up. But now I'm going to do something that I don't know if a lot of my fellow researchers do, and I'm going to put the town name in, but I'm going to put it into any field. So specifically, we're looking for Mglin, because that's where it says Joseph's from, and it says Jacob was born in, or is from, Starodub. So the assumption that we're going to make is that the family was in Mglin and then went to Starodub, where Jacob and his siblings were born. So we're going to look for the term Mglin, because more than likely, based on what I know in the revision list, we're going to see that mentioned if they're living in Starodub. So we want to see what families of this name are in that area. And we're going to be searching for something that hopefully will be along the lines of what we're looking for. So now we get our results and we get a good amount of stuff. And we have the Jewish Gen Family Finder and the Jewish Gen Family Tree of the Jewish People. The Jewish Gen Family Finder is people putting in their own family names and locations so you can contact them. The Jewish Gen Family Tree of the Jewish People comes from family trees that were built using the Jewish Gen system, and I think some that were loaded from other sites. I can't remember for sure. And then we have Belarus information, and we get Litvox Sig, and then we have Ukraine revision list, which is what we're really going to want to look at, and Jewish refugees in Tashkent. So we're going to look at the revision list first. And for these revision lists, we only have 13. And this is something to note, especially considering that we don't have an idea yet of how common is this name in that area. Because one thing that may help us is if this is a very uncommon name, or if it's not used as much in this town, we might be able to make some assumptions that a lot of the people with that name would then be related to the same family as Sam. But we also have to do that with a caveat of understanding the issues with that, where we don't have full correlating evidence. So when we're doing this stuff, what we want, the peak that we want to reach, is what's known as the genealogical proof standard, which is just a standard set of guidelines on how to have solid proof of what you conclude. So I have a whole video on that. I'm going to link that. I think it's going to be up here. It might be on this side. Somewhere up here, I'm going to link that, a video that I did previously on the genealogical proof standard. But as we're researching, we don't necessarily need to have concrete evidence to come up with hypotheses. We can come up with hypotheses and then look for that concrete evidence. But one thing I always like to do in my own research is if I'm going to be looking for something that's a hypothesis of, you know, different correlating evidence, I'm actually not going to be actively trying to prove that. I'm more going to be trying to actively disprove that first, because that might be an easier way to do things, especially considering if you're always trying to prove something, it's almost like you can always manipulate the evidence to fit what you're looking for. So that idea of let's try to disprove it first. So what we're doing here, we're looking at all these revision lists and we're seeing these families and we're looking for something that's going to match what we have in the family tree. Now, with Joseph, it's estimated he was born about 1859, just jumping back, looking at Joseph, 1859, no specific birth date. Then for his wife, Bessie, 1861. And then Jacob, 1885, and all of his siblings are younger than him. So born 1887, 1892, 1895, 1897. So this is giving us an idea of what we can look for when we're going to be looking in these records, because we want to find something that's going to match up to that. So going back to this list, we have 13 different entries of these different Aronovs where Mglin is mentioned, because we put in Mglin for any field. So we'll notice starting off, look, we have Makarovka in Starodub, Chernigov. And then over here under comments, registered in Mglin, Chernigov, Gubernia. Lives here for 3 years. Passport number 168 from March 18th, 1881. Has no property. Doesn't work. So this is actually matching up with what we're looking for. We're looking for a family that went from Mglin to Starodub, but the names here aren't matching anything. We have Meyer, his father Shlema, his wife Nechama, who's the daughter of Levick. Then we have children Gessel, Yessel, Alexander Zella, Bluma Devora, Chana Riva. So these people very well may be related to the family we're looking for, but it doesn't match up to anything that we're looking for. But then we get this next entry, and this one is really a good one. And this might actually be our family tree for Sam. So here we have Yessel, son of Kul. But if we remember Joseph, his father was not just Jacob, but on the grave, he was Yaakov Yehuda. So we are looking for a Joseph who's the son of a Yaakov Yehuda. So doesn't really fit, but Kul, K-U-L, is not a name that I'm familiar with. And one thing that's possible is that this could be a name that comes from Yaakov Yehuda or something similar. But one thing to remember is that we know that Sam's great-grandfather, Jacob Aronow, who, you know, we know is his great-grandfather, he came as Yankel Lieb. So we know that Jacobs in this family often, or at least in this case for Sam's great-grandfather, used Yankel. So we would also be looking for Yankel, and could Kul be from Yankel? So that's a possibility to consider. We have age 23. This matches up with exactly what Sam gave us. And then registered Mglin, Chernigov, Gubernia, lives here for 1 year, has no passport, has no property, sells horses. So that's matching up too. Then we know that we're looking for Joseph's wife to be a Bessie. And here we have Basia. We know that for Bessie, on her gravestone, her father's name is Yona, but here it's Yankel. But when doing this kind of research, you have to be loose with the names a bit and just kind of be considerate. But at the same time, remembering these are just hypotheses at this point. We haven't proven anything. Now, one of the beauties about Jewish Gen is that they do have links to the records if they are digitized most often. And here we do have that over on the right. And I'm going to click that, and that's going to take us to Family Search, because Family Search did a lot of digitization, and I believe they're starting to do more digitization again. So we pull this up, and I have a pretty decent understanding, basically, of handwritten script for Cyrillic. And here we have Aronov, and this is our entry. And often, if you can get that digitized entry, it's better to do that and look into it further, because what we're getting on Jewish Gen is a transcription. Someone read that, put it in, but people are not always correct. There's a lot of errors. If anybody follows the Twitter handle WTF Genealogy, I think that's it, all they post about is the craziest indexed information on like Ancestry and Family Search and other websites. So you can never always trust the transcriptions. You have to understand that as well. There's a context to not just the original record, but there's a context to the transcriptions in these databases that you see. I am not the best with Cyrillic. I have just enough understanding to be able to read most names. So what I would do from here, make use of Facebook groups. So what I did is I went to the group Jewish Genealogy Portal, which is an amazing group on Facebook for anyone doing Jewish genealogy. You can post questions and people can help you out. And that's one of the beauties about doing genealogy today, is that it's so easy to collaborate. And there's groups like this where there are tons of people that not only have these special expertise or understandings of things, but you also get a lot of people that live in Russia or have lived in Russia or Ukraine or a lot of these areas that you're looking, and they might know things that no one else really knows that well. So when I posted this, I was trying to get what's some information on this. Number one, what's the deal with this Kul? What's with that name? It sounds very interesting. Then as well, could any of the transcription be different? Now, when I looked at the transcription, the name is here, Kulov, right there. So I saw it. I thought, okay, it does say Kul. And even more, you can look down at the wife. You see Bessia Yankelova. I'm probably tearing up the way that you're supposed to pronounce it, but basically daughter of Yankel. So whoever took the transcription here obviously knew that there was the name Yankel and then another name. So our theory about could it be Yankel Cool, it's a little on edge. So I wanted to see what others thought. And so here's what a lot of posts that I got. So the first one was quick translation, Philistine Yesel, son of Cool Aronov. And then there were a few other talks in it, you know, first name Essel, Russian E, pronunciation is different, like Y-E as in yes. So then they both agreed, yeah, better translation is Yesel. So basically they're kind of confirming what we already saw here, Yesel. And in my experience, I do know Yesel is a decently common used name for people that have also gone by Joseph. So it makes sense to me. But then looking more, we get the same person saying, this is interesting. First name and father's name are both Tatar or Kazakh. Was he a Karaim? And I don't know if I'm pronouncing that correctly. I explained, not as far as I know, which I think this is actually really interesting. And this kind of goes up exactly the type of stuff that Sam talks about in his videos. Because I believe the Karaim were this small group that had ethnic ties to different Turkish groups. And they spoke this language, Karaim. But one thing that defined them, I believe, is that I can't remember exactly. They either believed in the Talmud or they didn't. So actually, let's take a look. This is actually a good thing. So Karaim, you can see I did a lot of searching on this and read up on it. And so Karaim language is a Turkic language with Hebrew influences in a similar manner to Yiddish or Judeo-Spanish. It is spoken by only a few dozen Crimean Karaites. Whether I'm not pronouncing this correctly, I don't know. But this is a very interesting thing. This is not something I would have known. And if the name really, you know, they seem to purposely put Cool, K-U-L. So if this is a common name among the Karaim, maybe is there a connection in Sam's family to that? Continuing on, looking at what was discussed in this thread, they do discuss, you know, it's hard handwriting to read. They're trying to figure out different stuff with the passport. So you can see it says he was deported, but I can't understand some words. So then he says, not sure if it was some kind of deportation. An appropriate order has been issued on the sending of Aronow to the community. But the word, and it looks like it's Bavisvilka. Bavisvilka. If I'm pronouncing that right, please comment below because I'd be surprised. But he says means deportation. So we're getting a little bit of an interesting context. We get somebody else saying townsman Essel Kulov Aronov, 21 years old, his wife Basia Yankleva, 21 years old. So matching up to what we thought. Pretty much everything kind of like what was said in Jewish Gen. So that's the main thing we're trying to get here, but we're also trying to get the context of the record, which we already know it's a revision list. And for those that don't know what a revision list is, it's basically a census where every time they take it, it's not just here's what the family looks like now, it's here's what the family looks like now and here's what they looked like in the past revision list and here's the family number from the past revision list and so on. So if we go back and look, we can actually see that if we scroll up, we can see page, registration number, and then former registration number. So they were registration number 276, which we look in, yes, registration 276. But this left column, that's last revision list. So they were not on the last revision list in Starodub. So they were most likely in Mglin in the last revision list. But going back to that conversation that they had, so at one point I eventually state my case and I say, do you think Call is a shortened name? I'm not familiar with this name, but I'm looking for Joseph Aronow, who we knew used Yesel as a name, which was confirmed through immigration documents from his son Moses. And it says he is the son of Yaakov Yehuda, who likely also went by Yankel. And remember, I mentioned this before, based on Sam's great-grandfather, Jacob, who also went by Yankel. Place, birth dates, and wife match as well, although I didn't mention that the wife's father didn't quite match. So what they said was, first, the person who had mentioned previously that might be a Tatar name. He says, Kol, Tatar name, means arm, also slave servant, slave of Allah, as often described. One thing that I asked, are there any other names that we can look for in the family as we do the research? So if we find more names that might fit this story, maybe there is a connection, or maybe there's just something else going on. So then we got this response also from Boris, who says, in your case, it all fits together. The document was filled in by a Christian official who was alien and incomprehensible to Jewish names. So we're getting some context on the record, because this is also important when doing records. What's the context? Who took the names? Would they have known how to write the names? Could there be something else going on? And then he even says the original sounded most quickly like Yosel Yukolev. Yukol equals Yaakov equals Yankel. A more precise answer can only be given by further research. Very, very true. So from here, we're going to be continuing with all of this stuff, and we want to go through the rest of the revision list to see, are there anything connecting to our Aronow family? And I already went through that. I was not able to find anything that connected, and at this point, this is kind of all we have. But we have more places to look. So one of the first things that I like to do as well is I want to find out what records are available for the town. Now, I talked in one of the previous episodes that we can go to the town finder, which is on Jewish Gen, and that can often have a lot of information. So you just put in the information, click this little star, the Jewish Gen symbol, and then it brings you to the town. It gives you all this information, alternative names, the region, and this is actually pretty bare for a town finder page, but it gives us some history too. So before World War I, circa 1900, the town Mglin, district of Mglin, province Chernigov in Russian Empire. Between the wars, it was the Russian SSR, Soviet Union. After the war, Soviet Union, and today it's in Russia, which is actually a very odd thing. A lot of the areas in the Pale, or the Pale of Settlement, where Jews lived in Eastern Europe, Russia, all of that, most of those areas are now in countries outside of Russia. And even most of the area of Chernigov, what was Chernigov, is in Ukraine. So it's actually a very interesting thing. But unfortunately for us, not all Russian records are quite as available as many of the Ukrainian records, partly due to different things going on in Ukraine. Biggest thing, dealing with Alex Krakowski, who has been digitizing records and suing archives that won't allow him to digitize it. And I think he's won all of his lawsuits. He's done amazing work. And some of my early videos, if you go back and look, I did a couple of videos about what he was doing, and it even got me on the news in Ukraine. So we're going to look into that. But the first place we're going to look is we're going to look into a Routes to Roots. And what Routes to Roots is, it's this website created by Miriam Wiener, who is someone that did a ton of work in the early days of the internet to create something for Jewish genealogy, because there was really almost nothing. And what this website is, you're not going to find records on it. You're going to find, where do records exist? And then that will help us find, are there any digitized yet? Is there something else that we're going to need to do? So we go to the archive database. We can search for different stuff. So we're going to do a quick search, and our town, Mglin, we're going to do search, comes up with nothing. So now we're going to do another search, and we're just going to change it a little bit. And here we get Mglin, Uzed, Bryansk. Yes, that's us. So we see what's available. It's in the country Russia. It's in the Bryansk province. There's a census, and it's in Chernigov. So we can see there's really not a whole lot. And it is available, State Archive of Chernigov Oblast. And we have year list 1882, what we already looked at, 1888, 1903, 1906, 1911. So nothing from before. So we're really at a difficult point. So now I'm going to go to look at Alex Krakowski's project. And to do that, there's a few ways. One way is you can go through the Sal Kaplan Foundation website. You can go to archives and you can see lots of other stuff that's available too. Go to Ukraine and then the Alex Krakowski project. And it shows everything that he has digitized. And if you click one of these links, that will take you to a digitized book. It's not searchable. You will have to go page by page to find it. But this is an easy way for people to be able to find what they're looking for if they have difficulty using like Google Translate and stuff. And then it's even broken up by province. And so it makes it really easy to look. But I prefer personally, and some might as well, going to the actual website that he does this on. And that's on the Ukrainian Wikimedia. So if you have Google Translate on, I use Chrome. So anyone else who uses Chrome, use Google Translate as an extension. And it's really helpful in this. And so here we get all of the things that are being archived. And we see we have Project Jewish Town, very major. But we want to see, is there anything for Chernigov? And we do have State Archives of Chernigov region. And there's really not a lot. We have funds of the pre-Soviet period. We have digitized descriptions. You can see I've already looked at it, but it's all stuff that's just a little too far out for us to be able to even connect anything to. So then we go back, put on our Google Translate, and we want to go to the Jewish Towns Project and go down. What do they have for Chernigov? And nothing really. We have nothing that connects to the areas that we're looking for. We're looking for Bryansk. Could it be possible that the family moved to any of these areas? Certainly. But without any sort of knowledge of what family members were there, we won't know what quite to look for. And Aronow could be a name that was adopted by different families that weren't related to each other. So from here, what are we going to do? It's kind of a standpoint. And this is where we get into the real nitty gritty. And, you know, we've slowly been morphing from that searching phase into this researching phase. And what I do is I then go to JRoots. Now, JRoots is a forum that is, I believe, based in Russia. It might be based in Ukraine. It is in Russian, or maybe it's Ukrainian. I mean, to be completely honest, I don't know the difference that well, but there is a difference. But using Translate, you get a lot of stuff, and it's fairly easy to use. It's best to do searches using Cyrillic writing. So I'm going to go and get the Cyrillic writing for Mglin. So when I click, you can actually see that I've already searched for Mglin. I've searched a lot of other random stuff. And so here we get a whole bunch of stuff popping up. But one thing to focus on that I like to do when I do JRoots, because you can get a lot of great stuff, but sometimes it'll just be little mentions of Mglin and all of that, is I'll look for the one where the topic is going to be the actual Mglin topic. So now we're going to go to the Mglin topic and we're going to see what are they talking about. And the first entry right off the bat is amazing. And I went to this website to get the further scoop, and this is going to be a big step for us. Well, thank you so much for checking out this video. I do hope that you enjoyed. If you did, please be sure to give it a thumbs up. That really does help me out. You can also click right about here if you'd like to subscribe. It is completely free to do so. And if you'd like to get access to content early, or even more, get access to exclusive content, be sure to become a patron of mine on Patreon. And not only will you get all of that fun access, but you'll also be helping support my channel. You can also follow me on Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram at GeneaVlogger. I'm the GeneaVlogger. See you in my next video.